It's good to be here. In a little red book in the Old Testament by the name of Lamentations, just tucked away in the heart of that little book, is this phrase, "Great is your faithfulness. Your mercies, they're new every morning." It's a great book. You ought to read it sometime. Just puts an exclamation point on the song that we've just been singing. Well, last week we talked about the home, the week before that about children, and we talked about the importance of passing on faith to the next generation. I want to take it a step further today and just change the situation a little bit, where we land in Deuteronomy 8 and we become the children there. And God becomes the Father that disciplines, trains, and moves us forward in the right way so that we know how to be proper parents to our children. I want to take you to Deuteronomy 8. I'm going to read the whole chapter. I planned on going through the whole chapter today, but I realized this morning when I was trying to put my thoughts together, or finish my thoughts would be a better way to put it, that I had way too much material. So I'm not sure what we'll do, but we'll do the first half of it anyway. It's a great, great chapter. Now, a lot of people come to me and say, are you going to talk about this? Are you going to talk about that? And I mean, what about all these other things in Deuteronomy? And my answer is, when I started this series, I said to you, we're going to pull out certain themes and just do some reflecting on this book. So no, not going to cover everything. The hard parts, I'm going to leave. probably we'll cover that off some other way. But we will get to some of the other bits that you'd like to talk about. But I do want to land on Deuteronomy 8 today. Let me read you the chapter. It's just 20 verses. It says, "Be careful to follow every command I'm giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land that the Lord promised on oath to your forefathers. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. Observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in his ways and revering him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with streams and pools of water, with springs flowing in the valleys and hills, and a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil and honey. A land where bread will not be scarce and you'll lack nothing. A land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he's given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I'm giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large, and your silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you'll forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful desert, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the desert, something your fathers had never known, to humble and to test you, so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me, but remember the Lord your God. For it's he who gives you the ability to produce wealth and so confirms his covenant which he swore to your forefathers as it is today. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you today that you'll surely be destroyed. Like the nations the Lord destroyed before you, so you'll be destroyed for not obeying the Lord your God." It's almost impossible, I think, to underestimate the importance of Deuteronomy chapter 8. This is huge, huge chapter. You might remember the words in Deuteronomy 8:3. They were on the lips of Jesus when he was tempted by Satan. And Satan tempted him. Jesus said in one of those temptations, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." So you get some hint there of the spiritual power of this chapter. It's obviously a chapter that Jesus had memorized and thought deeply about. Very, very important chapter in the Old Testament and in the book of Deuteronomy. Who should hear the words of Deuteronomy chapter 8? Who are these words for? Let me tell you who they're for. They are for people who are tempted to locate their meaning in the stuff that they have. They're for people who want to get their identity from what they have, or maybe who they are. If you're tempted that way, this chapter is a very important one for you to take to heart. It's also for people who are in transition. These were boundary people. People on the boundary between the wilderness and the promised land. They were about to cross over and become materialists. They had known anything before, really, tents maybe, few things that they needed to do life in the desert, but now they're about to transition, change into a settled lifestyle with houses and land and orchards, and it was a time of change in terms of leadership as well. The baton was being passed from Moses now to Joshua. If you're in a time of change or transition, this chapter is for you. Maybe you're starting a new job or retiring. Maybe you're getting married or going through a painful divorce. You're graduating. You're in the place where you've just lost a spouse or somebody you love. You are leaving home. You're selling the farm. For everybody in times of transition, this chapter is pivotal, critical. It's also for people who've been blessed by God with great blessing. These people were about to be blessed with great blessings. We have been blessed with great blessings. There are some very important warnings to take to heart when you're blessed by God in Deuteronomy chapter 8, because it's so easy to forget God. The idea of remembering is a big idea in Deuteronomy. In fact, in chapter 8 and verse 2, it says, remember. Chapter 8 and verse 18, remember your God. The chapter's bracketed by this idea of remembering and not forgetting God. It was Abraham Lincoln, I'm convinced, he was reflecting on this chapter. In a speech he gave in 1863, said these words. He said, "We have been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We've been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity. We have grown in numbers, wealth, and power as no other nation has ever grown. But we've forgotten God. We've forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. Intoxicated by unbroken success, we become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to the God that made us." Those words seem to me to be as relevant today as when he first spoke them south of the border, but they're as relevant north of the border as they are south of the border. The terrible danger of forgetting God. This chapter is a look back at the wilderness years, and it's a look forward to what's to come. And I like the way Christopher Wright summarizes it. He summarizes it with this statement, which is a great statement that captures, I think, the theme of the chapter. He says, "Remember God in the hard times of the past, and do not forget God in the good times of the future." That captures the chapter. Remember God in the hard times of the past, and don't forget him in the good times of the future. We're going to look at both sides of that, but this week, just the first side. Remember God in the hard times of the past. I suppose there's different ways of looking at history. And one of the ways of looking at history, at least the history of the Israelites in terms of their 40 years in the wilderness, was that it was a result of monumental failure on their part. So it became a great 40 years of futility and wasted time. That seems to be how Moses reflects on it in Psalm 90, but not here. The other way of looking at these 40 years here was that Moses sees that God has turned these 40 years into a tremendous learning experience that must never be forgotten. It wasn't just a matter of salvaging something positive from the wreckage of their failure. It was now a matter of learning the lessons that they needed to learn that would position them well for the future that God had for them. So Moses sees now these 40 years as a great learning experience. You might recall the story of Joseph, or even the cross of Jesus itself. Both birthed in sin. Joseph, the sin of his brothers, caused him to be taken away as a prisoner. You know the story, eventually becoming second in command in Egypt. But though it was birthed in sin, that story, God's purposes were worked out through it. Same with the cross. It was Pilate and Judas and their great sin that handed Jesus over to be crucified, and yet it was the very purpose of God to bring good out of that. Same with the wilderness wanderings. It was birthed in sin. We can't go in there. We'll never be able to defeat those giants. And in unbelief and fear and sin, they turned away. And yet God uses that very thing to teach them for their own good so that in the end it would go well with them. Let me make sure you get this about God. God wastes nothing. He works not just in the ideal of our life, but in the reality of our lives. And perhaps that's where the only place he can work, in the reality of our lives. Some of us think that because of the wreckage of our lives and the poor choices we've made and all the things that have happened, that God can no longer work with us. I'll tell you what, God works in the reality of our lives, not in the ideal. God wastes nothing. He works everything together for his purposes, for good to those that love him. And he works as a father working with his child, his son. That's what verse 5 of chapter 8 says. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. He works as a father with his child. Proverbs says in chapter 3 that the Lord disciplines those he loves as a father the son he delights in. And then the writer of Hebrews picks that up and adds a bit. He says, endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as sons. Now, all that to say this, that when they look back on their past, I'm sure there was a lot they would like to forget, just like there is with you and me. I look back at my past, there's things I love to remember. There's a whole lot of stuff I just want to bury and forget and never think about again. And yet, verse 2, what does it say? It says, remember how the Lord your God, listen to these words, led you all the way. In other words, he wants them to look back and remember everything, all the way God has led them. Don't leave one stone unturned. Why? Because there were some incredible lessons to learn from the past that they would need moving into their future. And it's exactly the same with us. So I thought all I'd like to do is just trace out at least 4 of the lessons that they were to learn from these 40 years in the wilderness. Lessons that you need to learn, that I need to learn when I reflect on my past. Good, bad, and ugly. Here's the lessons. They're very simple, but they're very profound. 1, they were to learn dependence on God. He humbled you these 40 years. What does that mean? He worked to knock out of you your self-confidence. They were so self-confident, just like you and me. What did God do? He humbled them in order that they might know that they were totally and utterly dependent on God day after day after day. And so he caused them to hunger, and so that they would cry out to him. And when they cried out to him, he answered. He caused them to be thirsty. Why? So they would cry out to him, and he could meet their need. He was teaching them to be dependent on them. Now, this would be a very, very important lesson. Do you know why? Because shortly, they would be blessed with great prosperity. And it's so easy to forget that we're utterly dependent on God when everything's going well. You walk out in this parking lot, there are millions of dollars worth of cars, and there's more in our homes, and there's houses, and there's boats, and there's condos, and there's places all over the world that we have so that we can come and go whenever we want on vacation. We have been blessed more than most of the people on the face of the earth. And you know what happens when you're blessed? We forget that we're utterly dependent on God for our very breath, day after day after day. They had to learn this lesson so that when they prospered, they would never, ever forget it. They had learned in the day of trouble, they could call on God who would hear them and answer them. They were to learn that in prosperity, they were to call on God too and give praise and worship and thanks to the God that richly provided everything for their own enjoyment. Here's a second lesson. They needed to learn their weaknesses, the places where they would fall into sin most easily. He humbled you in order to test you to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. Now, it's a strange phrase that the God that knows everything wants to know what's in their heart. I think it's probably just a way of saying this, that he put them through what he put them through in order that what was in their hearts would become crystal clear to everybody around the table, God, them, everybody else. They would get to know their hearts. That's a very important thing when you look back at the past, because you know what? I do not want to remember my stumbles into sin. I don't want to think about my bad. I want to bury that and get on with it. But you know what this verse tells me? I need to pay attention to that. Why? Because where I fell into sin, I was weak. And if I recognize that, my job now is to shore up the weaknesses in my character and make sure that never happens again. What did they learn about their hearts? They learned that they were grumblers, that they were complainers, that they were fearful, that they were immoral, that they were proud, that they were idolaters. Now, God asked you to look back and say, or ask questions like, where does my character need most strengthening? Where are my most undefended parts? What do I need to avoid to keep from falling back into sin? What counsel would God give me in order that sin might not trip me up again? That's really, really important stuff. Do you know your heart? Can you look back and say, it was because of this unguarded thing or moment that I fell into sin here? So how am I going to change that? Here's a beautiful psalm. It's Psalm 32. It's a great one. Somebody's fallen into sin, David, and so he comes, he confesses his sin, and he says, blessed is the man whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sin the Lord doesn't count against him. Isn't that good? Forgiven, sin isn't counted against. We love that. But what happens next? If you keep reading, you'll get down to verse 8, where God speaks and he says, I will counsel you. I will guide you. I will instruct you with my eye on you. What's important about that? You need to link the two. We fall into sin because at some point we stop listening to godly counsel. And God says, yes, I'll forgive your sin, but now I want to counsel you so that we can build up those weak parts and you never have to go back that way again. Here's the deal. Can I tell you what I do when I confess sin? This is literally what I do. Most of the time, I get down on my knees and I just agree with God that what he says about what I've done is true and I confess it to him. Then you know what I do? I wait. I wait to listen for the God who speaks to tell me I'm forgiven and it's okay and I'm loved and accepted and we can move forward. You know what most of us do? We so quickly confess our sin, we rush off. We never get to hear God saying, I love you. You're forgiven. Your debt has been paid. We don't have a relationship with a set of principles. We have a relationship with a person that speaks, who you offend when you sin, who actually wants to speak back into your life when you come back to make it right. So you need to learn to not be in a hurry with God. You will never get to know God personally, really, intimately, if you're in a hurry. You have to wait. He's not in a hurry. So you need to wait. And then after that, you know what I find? I find that he's a God who bends down and lifts up my head. I told you a few weeks ago that when my little grandson, Rain, when he screws up, he will not look up. So I have to get down on my knees like this, and after we've done the deal and it's all done, I have to actually literally put my hand under his chin, lift his face up so we see eye to eye, and I tell him we're good and we can move forward. That's what it means when it says he's the lifter up of my head. He lifts our heads up. He makes us look him in the eyes, and he gives us wise counsel now about how to move ahead. Now, what do you do with that counsel? If you ignore it, you'll fall right back into sin. But when God gives counsel, maybe it's through Scripture, you grab that Scripture and you memorize it so that you'll never forget it. When the person on the throne at the center of the universe talks to you about your life, you should never forget what he said. You memorize it. Then you begin to pray it. You say, Father, may this be so. Then you ask the Holy Spirit to empower you to be able to do what he's asked you to do. God is not in a hurry. If you're in too much of a hurry, you'll miss the riches and the wisdom of the counsel that he wants to give you. You look back and you learn your weakness, but now you learn that God has counsel to keep you from going back the way that you went. It's very important not just to cover this stuff up and forget about it and do business with God on it. Now, here's the third thing that you ought to remember from the past, and that's simply this. We learn what the most important things in life are. The wheat gets separated from the chaff, if I could put it that way. I mean, verse 3 says, he humbled you, causing you to hunger, then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known to teach you. That we don't live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. The text does say that we don't live on bread alone, but it doesn't say we live by the word of God alone. Both are necessary. Bread here is physical food and material things. And the word of God is the spiritual food. We need both, in other words, to make it work. But if all you do is eat and drink, all you're doing is merely existing. To receive God's truth is to truly live as God intends you to live. The point is that there's more needed to have a successful life than just material things, just stuff. If that's all you're living for, there'll always be that sense that I haven't quite got it yet. It's physical bread that keeps us alive. It's the word of God that keeps us spiritually alive, shapes us, directs us, gives purpose, gives meaning to our lives. Bread. Physical bread. Spiritual truth. And then Jesus comes along in John 6 and says, I'm the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry and never go thirsty. And you get that he's talking about those deep things in our heart that make us hunger and thirst for things we can't fill ourselves. He says, whoever comes to me, I'll never turn away. Awesome stuff, John 6. But I think when you read, man does not live on bread alone, but every word that comes from the mouth of God, you are being challenged, along with me, to reflect on our values. What's really important in life? What am I really living for? Your values, you're challenged by this. I mean, you ought to be able to say, here's my values. And if they're all on the material side, then you're in a little bit of trouble and you need to make some changes. Not that the material is wrong, but the big rock stuff is the stuff that comes from God and from his heart. You know, when we were first married young, one of our number one values that we've lived out ever since was that we would make it a priority every Sunday to be in the house of God with the people of God, to hear words from the living God who speaks. And we wouldn't compromise on that for sports, for nothing. You say that's easy, you're a pastor, and you're right. I have to be here. They pay me to be here, okay? You don't get paid to be, you give money to be here, I get paid to be here. So it's a great deal. If you can get this gig, you should get it. But I'll tell you something. This started long before I ever knew I was going to be a pastor. When we were first married, I think if Ginny knew where we were going to go, we might not have got married. But I told her I was in real estate. I was going to be a millionaire by 40. It would all be good, I said. Didn't quite make it. Where's I going with this? But before I was ever thinking of being a pastor, our value was to gather with the people of God on the Lord's Day to worship and to hear words from the living God. And we've never really compromised that. When our kids were small, we went to Penticton every summer. We always went to Penticton Alliance on Sundays. Why? Because our value was to gather with the people of God, to worship God and hear words from the living God. That was our value. This summer, we were on a cruise up to Alaska. What do you do on a ship? Well, we were with our good friends, Steve and Sylvia, and we're sitting around drinking coffee at the latte bar, and then we saw a bulletin that said there's an evangelical Christian Protestant. They had about 10 names, little service in some room off the main lounge. I thought, hey, Steve, we should go there. It's Sunday. Let's do it. So we went in there, and you know, there's about 40 people gathered there, and the cruise people, they didn't know what an evangelical Protestant service was, so there was nobody leading it. And there was just 40 of us sitting there looking at the ground, feeling awkward. And one bold lady, probably from the States, said, I just love Tracy and Denise. I just had to say that for you guys. But she said, well, is there no pastor in the room? And I thought, oh, I hate that question. Busted. But before I could respond, praise the Lord, an old man, older than me, got up with his cane, and he said, I've been a pastor for 50 plus years. And he walked up the front, and he turned around, and I heard stuff that was the best stuff I heard all summer. It was one of the best sermons I've ever heard, and I've heard all of mine. And he said, I just want to tell you, he said, of God's faithfulness in our life from the time we were very young to this very day. And he said, I'm 86 years old. And he gave us a story of his life, how God is faithful even to your old age and gray hairs. It was rich stuff. It was one of the high points of the cruise, actually. And he said how that they had no money, but it was their anniversary. Their first marriages had ended because of the death of the spouses, and they'd been married about 10 years, and so was their anniversary. One of their kids said, we want to send you to Vancouver. They were from Texas to Vancouver. We're going to put you on a ship to Alaska. And he said, this is all a gift from God, and I am so grateful. I thought, what if I had sat at the latte bar and read my stupid book? I would have missed hearing from the living God who speaks. You know what? Your values are actually passed on to your kids. Let me just go for it. If sports is number one, don't expect that value to change with them and with their kids. My son Rick and Jen were in Palm Springs last week, and he Facebooked Jenny. I hate Facebook, so I'm not on it. I mean, who cares about what you're... Never mind. That's a whole other sermon, but anyway... I do have a smartphone, that's all though. But what did he Facebook? Oh yeah, he Facebooked. He said, Mom, can you ask Dad where we can go to church here in Palm Springs on Sunday? That warmed my heart last week. You know why? I thought, they've got it. They're making it a priority to gather with the people of God on the Lord's Day to worship God and to hear from the living God who never fails to speak. When you look back at the past and you look at all the mistakes, all the rubble, and all the other stuff, and you remember that we don't live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God, it has a way of separating the wheat from the chaff, so that when God wants to prosper you and bless you and give you hope and a future, you never forget the most important things in life. It's all here. And then one last thing, and I better wind it down here, but I think looking back on the past, they would be very aware, when they gave much thought to it, of the riches of God's grace. The length, the breadth, the height, the depth, not only of God's love, but his grace, the exceeding riches of his grace. You say, how so in these 40 miserable years on the desert would they ever see grace? Well, every single day they got manna. You know what manna was? Not many people do. Even the Israelites didn't, and I don't either. But it was just white stuff that fell on the ground. And the Hebrew word would translate fairly loosely into whatchamacallit. That's really the word, whatchamacallit, manna. Nobody knows, but it's good. Let's eat it. It keeps us alive. In Exodus 16, you know what they were told? Take enough for one day for your family, but no more. Why? Because they were learning to be dependent on God for their next day's bread. But some people, it says, paid no attention at all. And they gathered enough for 2 or 3 weeks, and it got rotten and horrible with maggots in it. Moses and God were unhappy, which would be an understatement with their disobedience. But even as they failed the test, you know what? The manna didn't fail them. They were being taught about the grace of God. Then you look at their long, sordid history. Psalm 106 will actually summarize it nicely for you. From the time they left Egypt, all the years in the desert, then till they went into captivity. And it talks about how many times they failed God. They grieved him. They put him to the test. But God was unwilling to give them up or abandon them. Many, many times over, he forgave their sins and didn't treat them as they deserved. And he ran after them with arms wide open. You talk about the riches of God's grace. John Bunyan wrote an incredible book called Pilgrim's Progress. It has never been out of print from the time it was first published in the 1600s up until today. You should read it. And God keeps a book around that long. It's worth reading every year. He wrote another book, which is a spiritual autobiography, which is less known, called Grace Abounding to the Chief of Sinners. He, being the chief of sinners and having experienced God's grace, wanted to just lay it out there for all of us. He has an unforgettable line in there, which I can't forget. This is a line in his book. He says, if rebels run away from God, he lovingly pursues them with a pardon in his hand. Isn't that a great picture? If rebels run away from God, he lovingly pursues them with a pardon in his hand. Hey, come back. Your debt has been paid. It's okay. You can come home. That's the grace of God that these people experienced. This last week, Pastor Ken did a funeral for Dave Epp. And he said something that I probably won't ever forget. Up here, Pastor Ken said this. He said, you know, he said, every time I have come back to God, no matter what I've done, he's never failed to receive me graciously. Isn't that amazing? Every time I, in truth and humbly, have come back to God, he's never failed to receive me graciously. Now, Pastor Ken is no spring chicken. I mean, he's in his seventh decade. So when he speaks and says that, it would be wise to listen. God never, ever turns away people who humble themselves and come in truth and seek his grace. These people were to learn the riches of his grace so that when they prospered, they would understand that the only proper response to everything in life was thank you, thank you, thank you. And they were to give thanks before and after their meals for the wonderful provision that God provided day after day after day after day. And that brings me to where we are today. The table of the Lord is a great and a fitting way to end this service because it too says, remember and give thanks. It's the cup of remembrance, but also the cup of thanksgiving, where we remember and never let slip from our memories all that God has done for us in Jesus Christ. When Jesus Christ was nailed to the cross, do you know what happened? God piled all of our sin on him, and he paid the debt in full. And we ought never to forget that. Do you remember the great hymn, It Is Well With My Soul? I think the first line is something like, when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say. It's on the screen, for Pete's sake. It is well with my soul. But don't you love the other line? Another verse, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. What? Praise the Lord, oh, my soul. What? Can we just take a second and stand and sing that? Let's do a couple of those things. We got anybody back here? Good, let's do it. Oh, great.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll,
whatever.
With my soul,
my sin, know the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin not in part, but the
You can have a seat for a moment. You know, as poppies are emblems of Remembrance Day and all that that stands for, so the bread and the cup are emblems that remind us that our sin, not in part, but the whole, was nailed to the cross. You remember Jesus on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, they were eating, and he broke it, and he passed it around, and he said, "This is my body for you." And then after supper, he took the cup, and we have juice, but he used wine, and he poured it into the cup. Then he passed it around, and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for many. We are part of the many." And today our awesome privilege is to take bread and to take the cup and remember what Jesus did for us and give thanks to him. He didn't stay dead. He's alive. He's risen from the dead. So he can hear your thanks and your praise. And remember that we only do this until he comes back. We may never do this again here. It might be there. It'll be a great day. In a moment, I'm going to pray and give thanks for the bread and the cup. And then you just come on up when you want to receive it, when you're ready, as we normally do. We'll go back to our seats when we all have it. We'll eat it and drink it together. This is for people who love Jesus, want to walk in his ways. It's also for people who would like to. If you've never put your faith and trust in Jesus, you can do it today. Your first step of faith could be to take bread and say, "He did it for me," and to drink the cup and say, "My confidence is in what Jesus did for me." Let me tell you how to know Jesus. Faith is not just a mental assent to a bunch of beliefs. Beliefs are incredibly important. You have to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for your sins, which means you're a sinner. You have to believe that if you trusted him and what he did, God would forgive you and cleanse you and all of that. But that's not enough. It's not enough to know this stuff. It's not enough even to believe it, because you know what real faith is? It is a relationship of trust with a real person. That's what it is. It's knowledge, it's belief, but it's a personal trust in Jesus Christ. And some of you need to take that step where you decide, "I'm going to act on my belief, and today I'm going to trust Jesus Christ personally." And it just takes, "Lord, remember me." You can come, take bread and take the cup, if you're willing to trust him. So let me pray and then invite you to come to the table. Father, we thank you today for your word. We thank you for this place. We thank you that we can worship, that you feed us with rich food from your word, but also we get to feed on the bread and drink the cup and remember all that you did for us, Lord Jesus. As we take the bread, we thank you, remembering that you yourself and your body bore our sins on the cross. As we drink the cup, we give thanks because it represents the precious blood of Jesus that cleanses from all sin. So, Father, would you meet with us in your Son as we sit together around this table, in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
too lost to be saved, I'm too broken for a shame. All are welcome in His grace. Oh, see His body, His blood. Know that He has overcome every trial we will face. I'm too lost to be saved, I'm too broken or ashamed. All are welcome in His grace. By Your mercy we come to Your table. By Your grace You are making us faithful. Lord, we remember You. And remembrance leads us to worship. And as we worship You, our worship leads to communion. We respond
stand together. We have bread, we have the cup, and not only do we remember what Jesus did on the cross, but we remember that through His work we become family, one, and we eat this cup and we drink this bread together, saying that we're brothers and sisters in Christ. So let's take the bread, remembering Jesus said, "This is for you." And then the cup, His blood, poured out for the remission of our sins. And so, Father, we give thanks for this simple way of remembering all that You've done for us. We pray as we feed upon the bread and drink the cup that You would give us life by Your Spirit this week to live and to walk in Your ways, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.